think we are probably the first region where this is designed to sort of formalize a platform to engage specifically with our nations, have been around for almost 3 years. It was an initiative of SDGs, and then we had really good discussions on how to deepen more systematically national and regional engagement with UN issues at SDGs level, and we are back to the global level as well. So thank you very much. I think we're all in agreement that the SDGs and the 2030 agenda, which is the broader package of what we are trying to achieve, are an opportunity again to try and reshape development and to deal with systemic failures. This is not new. We had this 20-something years ago in something called Agenda 21, which nobody talks about anymore. But that was really ambitious because it was an agenda for the 21st century, not just 15 years. It lacks specific goals, and I think that's why not just Agenda 21, but we saw the 90s have many, many summits on social development, on women, on population, on water, you name it, we have it. So it's not that we don't have legally binding treaties in climate change, in human rights, diversity, or justification of land degradation. It's not that we don't have programs, actions, ideas, even targets and indicators. We have them all. But why do we not do the transformation? What we do have today that we have less of in the 90s is more systemic failures, which calls for what, like in the Agenda 2030, transformation. So we have these very big words about transformation and structural change. But when we come to a lot of the talk about the actions, then we somehow go back to sort of business as usual. I think for our region in the Asia Pacific, you know, the MDGs, we all know, were sort of, in a way, a selected number of limited targets to be doable. You know, from the range of stuff in the 1990s, which is really a very ambitious package, it's super relevant today. The MDGs actually had one very important engine, MDG 8. We had no targets, which is why, you know, for SDGs in your report, we don't have one on MDG 8, because we didn't finish the work on what MDG 8 should be about. If we had MDG 8 implemented on recent implementation and the global partnership of inter-state multilateral responsibilities, then we would have some of the structural transformation that is missing today. So the failure of MDG 8 is something I think that was really much redressed in the SDGs negotiation. So the whole of the 2030 agenda is very strong on the means of implementation. And we find it in every one of the goals, targets, and even freestanding target on MOI, which is why many of us are rather disappointed in that icon on MDG 17. Talks only about global partnership, but that somehow lost the means of implementation part, which is very crucial. For us, in the civil society sphere, we have a lot of faith that the political commitment that's been renewed is there, but as we go back to work, we would like to focus on a number of issues. In our region, we have had huge successes in economic growth, but we've also seen huge inequality within countries and within the region. So for us in the Asia Pacific, the principle of common but differentiated responsibility, the need for equality and equity are very much within our region's challenges, and we have to deal with that. In the small countries, the landlocked countries, in the big countries with population, with new financial resources. In South-South regional cooperation is again a very forerunner in our region. So there are potential new financial resources for some countries. We have a lot of work and discussion in the Addis Ababa Finance Development Bank of public finance to taxation. I think we may all be looking at the private sector. We have been looking to the private sector for investments for a long, long time for sustainable development. It has not happened. And it's understandable. The private sector investor and institutional investors are still limited, as you were saying, sir, grappling with what these goals mean, because the business institution is still very much dominant in the theory of investors. So there are, of course, enlightened businesses. There are corporate leaders who want to do something different. The dominant model remains the same. So, and I think that the reliance and over-optimism on private sector financing of development and sustainable, we have to be very cautious about that. We in the civil society movement and many governments we heard in the Addis Ababa conference wanted more work and multilateral cooperation on taxation. If we look at taxation, illicit, tax havens, transfer pricing, corporate taxes that don't get paid. We look at the whole tax structure of our societies in the developed world, we have moved back. That is the most important tool for revenue generation. If we don't bring that back to the center of our MOI, then relying on partnerships in the private sector ain't going to get us anywhere. And And then to the issue of partnership, the most basic partnership for us in the civil society and recognizing the agenda 2030 and the SDGs, the basic, most fundamental partnership is a partnership of states. Because in the United Nations, state responsibility and the role of government to give us coherence in policy, to give us coherence in institutions at the domestic level to the global level, to give us accountability and transparency and inclusiveness of the highest level, it has to be in the public sector, whether in our own countries or in the United Nations. So for us, that fundamental global partnership of states has to be the overarching one, within which we have partnerships of intergovernmental organizations, which themselves are answerable to their own governance of states. And what we see today, that was a renewal of the partnership. A lot of things have happened, a lot of lessons have been learned, and those partnerships are the second criteria of partnerships, very important. Partnerships are not new. All of us have worked at different levels. We have partnered with parliamentarians in charge of democratic control. We have partnered with parliamentary committees and parliamentarians and trade unions and CSOs and women's groups to fight against agreements that are very bad for sustainability and human rights. So we have partnerships across the board. What we need to think about is if we want partnerships to implement and to bring in finance to set norms, we need to have very clear rules. And we are not all equal around the table. I'm so glad that Sir, you brought up this thing about vested interests. There are very conflicting interests sometimes around the table. So we do need to think about how, when we move into this other type of public-private partnerships, we talk about all the time in every one of our General Assembly meetings. Those open up new questions. In the partnership interactive dialogue a few days ago, somebody raised this issue. Once finance begins to be put in by non-state actors, what will be the degree of influence, undue influence, positive, negative risks that come into the norm setting of the United Nations and of national governments? It was a very good question from the International Anti-Corruption Ministry. So, and Mr. Ban Ki-moon in the Secretary General's report on global partnerships in 2013 actually says this. As partnerships with the private sector become more widespread and significant, it is essential that the United Nations put in place and improve existing integrity measures at all main interfaces with the private sector, protect its brand and reputation, the UN's brand and reputation, promote responsible business practices and United Nations values, and achieve greater coherence between the agendas of the United Nations and the agendas of businesses. This is something that is in the Secretary General's report on partnerships. So I would like to just then quickly touch on what we as CSOs see ourselves as contributing. We play many roles. CSOs are also very different. Philanthropy groups are also very different. We have different interests. And so we need to have a framework of engagement before we work with ASEAN at the regional level. And we are asking of this also at the global level from the New York UN system and across all the UN agencies. Let's have some clear understanding of principles and rules of engaging in partnership. Let's be clear the different types of partnership. And as CSOs, we can bring contributions in terms of contributing to norm setting, policy making, in terms of implementation, in terms of bringing together not just NGOs at only one level, we are also hoping to work more and more linking between farmers, indigenous peoples, women, workers, and all that we are all doing together for a long time. How do we do it better? So coherence and institutional policy is something that we'll be turning to us from now on. The policy space issue is very critical. We as CSOs are fighting as more and more things get globalized. In every international forum, we are fighting for policy space for our national governments. Because at the national level, ultimately, where implementation has to take place, we do not want to see sustainable development aspirations and five-year plans and development plans of our governments be actually countered by trade or financial rules in the international arena, or even the new regional or bilateral trade agreements that are very anti-human rights and anti-sustainable development. So we are trying all the time to fight for policy space, and we are very happy policy space is recognized in Goal 17, and how do we make that real? So we reaffirm our commitment from civil society in the region that we will continue to work with our governments at home and at the regional level and at global level, and but also recognize that we are diverse, we will be different, and you do not want to hear the same voices all the time. The issue of vested interests and conflict of interest is absolutely crucial. So the work on how to have a conflict of interest policy in any engagement partnership is really, really important. Thank you very much.